Amen. What an awesome spirit in this place today. Has God been good to you this week? But no matter what has happened this week, that God is still good. Amen. Amen. I know it's the we got quite a few people out. It's the holiday season. People are traveling. People have got go see family and things like that. But it is good to be in the house of the Lord today. You may go ahead and be seated. I don't know about you guys, but anybody ready for Thanksgiving? I figured I'd have a few more people excited about Thanksgiving. Anybody ready to eat at Thanksgiving? Amen. That's the best part of Thanksgiving, isn't it? Is the eating. But glad to be in the house of the Lord today. I will go ahead and read my main scripture, and then I have an illustration or a story, if you want to call it that. But I will be reading today from 1 John chapter 2. Verses 15 through 17, and actually I have a couple more verses I'll be reading throughout this message, and they'll put those on the screen. But the main scripture for today will be 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. I'll give you a moment to turn there. And I do apologize if anybody texts you and says that they cannot find the sermon today or the message, the service today online. Our internet has gone down. But if you talk to somebody and they miss today, we are recording the sermon, so we can re-upload this at a later date. But our internet did go down this morning. All right, 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, then the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and the pride of life, it is not from the Father, but it is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. And so I am going to bring you a message today titled Contrasting Kingdoms. And this will make sense as we go through this, but we touched a little bit on this Wednesday night in our discipleship class. Brother TJ was teaching, but we were talking about different ways that God speaks to us, and many people in here share different ways that God speaks to you. I believe that with everybody, it's probably a little bit different. I've never audibly heard the voice of God. I've never been woken up in the middle of night with a thunderous voice from heaven telling me something. If God speaks to you that way, then I am glad that he does, but there are definite times in my life where I've heard the voice of God. And sometimes it may be through prayer, it may be through reading the Bible, it may be in conversation with somebody. Sometimes God sends us people to speak into your life. Anybody ever had that where somebody you may not even know? I've had that happen. I've been at a church service visiting another church or been at a convention. Somebody just come up to me and say, hey, I think that, you know, I've got a word from you. You don't know me, but I think God told me to tell you this, and it's right what you needed. And so there's all these different ways that God speaks to us. And so, as I've been working on this message for a couple of weeks now, I will tell you this. God spoke to me through an Instagram reel of Dave Ramsey. Some of y'all are laughing. Some of y'all don't know Dave Ramsey, but we're very familiar with Dave Ramsey in the hyphen class. We are big fans of Dave Ramsey. And now, whether you like Dave Ramsey or not, whether you follow his advice or not, this message is not about financial responsibility. Don't worry. I'm not going to tell y'all to cut up all your credit cards and pay cash for everything and all that. Whether you follow Dave or not, irrelevant to this. But it just so happened that I was watching this reel because I get cracked up at Dave Ramsey. I like Dave Ramsey. I think he has some good advice. But Dave Ramsey's kind of like, he's kind of got that dad sort of feel to him. Like, he's going to tell you that you're an idiot and you screwed something up. But then he's going to give you some tough love and tell you how to fix it. You know, he just kind of feels like that father figure. And so I get cracked up with his social media and the clips from his show where people call in and talking about stuff. But this particular one, this guy had called in to the Dave Ramsey show. And he was like, me and my longtime girlfriend were big fans of your show. We have followed your advice. He's like, I just wanted you to know that we've paid off all of our debt. You know, we've paid off all of our student loans. We've done all this. We've got money. So, you know, and they're just going on, like, basically just telling Dave Ramsey that they have followed his program and it has worked. And so they're going on at this, and he And then the guy says, you know, but I've got a question. I've got something coming up. He said, I think me and my girlfriend, we're ready to buy a house, and this is a big purchase, and we want some advice from you about this. And it's funny because his very next piece of advice, Dave Ramsey says, well, you shouldn't buy a house together unless you're going to put a ring on it. It wasn't what I was expecting, and it caught my attention. I thought, well, that's, you know, it's kind of funny, but it's kind of true, too. And he's giving them some reasons. Like, you know, if you're going to buy a house together, that's a pretty big commitment. You need to make sure you're actually committed to each other before you go and buy this big purchase together. And then the guy replies, and he says, well, we've got it all figured out. You know, we both have good-paying jobs, but I make more money than she does, even though we both do good. So we're going to divvy everything up like this, and she's going to pay for this, I'm going to pay for that. I just want to know what you think about that. Dave Ramsey says, well, the first problem is if you're in a serious relationship, there is no hers and his, it's ours. I thought, wow, Dave's preaching. He's not just giving financial advice. Dave Ramsey's doing some preaching here. He's like, if you are going to get married and buy a house together, he said, you need to quit with this. This is mine, this is hers, this is whatever. He's like, it becomes ours. And he said, look, he said, you know, I've done very well for myself. He said, I've been very successful. He said, I'm a millionaire now. He said, my wife used to work at the company with me, but she doesn't any longer. He said, but all the millions I have in the bank is her money too. He's like, I don't go home and tell her that she needs to go write books and make her own money. It's our money. We're married. And I thought, wow, that's pretty good advice. I like that. So whether you follow Dave Ramsey or not, he's giving out some biblically sound advice here. And then my positive thinking and being happy about this was quickly crushed because I went to the comment section. I'll just tell you, if you're on the internet, don't ever read the comments to anything. If you watch YouTube videos, don't read the comments. If you watch Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, don't go read the comments. Comments are just full of trash and people just being negative about everything. You have a video on there of these puppies playing, something super happy, and people being just Debbie Downers being in the comments telling you how terrible it is. But I went to the comments. This is where God started to speak to me. I went to the comments. I was expecting for people to be amen and Dave Ramsey. He's preaching. All the comments are like, Dave, don't you know this ain't 1950 anymore? People ain't got to get married to do this. People don't need this. You need to have your own bank accounts. You need to be doing this. And they're just bashing all this advice. And I'm thinking, well, whether you like him or not, Dave Ramsey's proven that his system works. I mean, he is pretty successful. And I'm looking at some of y'all's profiles, and y'all are not very successful, but you're telling this guy who is very successful. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but when I want some advice on something, I go to people that know what they're talking about that have proven themselves. If I have a plumbing issue, I go talk to somebody that knows a lot about plumbing because I don't know a lot about plumbing. Amen? If I hire an electrician, I want an electrician that knows what they're doing so my house don't burn down when I flip the lights on. I'm like, y'all are bashing this guy's advice, but he's evidently proven that it works. And God began speaking to me, and I felt this so strongly, is that the principles of God will always seem outdated to the world. The principles of God will always be at odds with the principles of the world. And if you were to list them out, I can tell you this, there are way more benefits to following God than not. Living by Christian principles cannot only help you live a good life, but they can save you from a lot of heartache in your life. Living a good moral life will help you in your personal life, your relationships, your marriage, your business, your career, your education. Pretty much any area in your life will be made better if you put Christ at the front of it. Don't worry, we're not prosperity preaching here because the prosperity gospel is where you treat God like he owes you something, okay? I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that God takes care of the needs of his children. Amen. Because I can tell you this, I have proven it. I've proven it in my own life. I can tell you this, there are some very successful people in this church. There are people in this church that have been married for a long time. There's people in this church that own their own businesses. There's people in this church that have great careers. I don't know about you, but I kind of like the sound of doing good in life. Amen. And so I got to thinking about this so strongly, and it just hit me that the world, we're always going to be at odds with the world. We're never going to fit in with the world. The things that we do, the way that we live our life, we should not care if the world agrees or disagrees with it, because I don't live the way I live my life to impress the world. I do the things I do in my life because I believe it's a great way to live, and I believe it honors the one true God. And so we can divide this up. And first, let's take a look at the principles of the world. What does the world actually preach? What does the world actually offer you in life? 1 John chapter 2, verse 16, from our scripture that we read. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life, it is not from the Father, but it is from the world. So let's look at these three aspects of worldly principles. So if you're taking notes, that will be the desires or the lust of the flesh, the desires or lust of the eyes, and pride of life. Because that's what the scripture said that the world has to offer. This is how the world tells you that you should live. So the first one, the desires of the flesh. This is defined as sinful desires driven by physical gratification. Examples of this would be overindulgence, immorality, addiction. Doesn't sound very positive, does it? But that's what our world offers today. Our world has no self-control in anything. We don't have self-control. Addiction is rampant. If you don't believe me, just look at anything, any recent studies. We've got crisis about people being addicted to this, people addicted to that. Addiction is rampant in our society. Immorality is rampant in our society. And basically what this is saying is that on our own, we are weak. This goes back to the message I preached not too long ago about the power of the Holy Spirit. On my own, I cannot overcome my flesh. On my own, I am too weak, and I give in to those desires of the flesh. Because the world says, please your flesh. Whatever it is that you want to do, just go ahead and do it. Whatever you want to be involved in, just go ahead and be involved in it. It doesn't matter. Just do whatever feels good in the moment. But when fleshly desires rule us, it takes priority over God's will in our life, and this will cause us to violate God's righteousness. This is when those desires of the flesh, when they become lust, because they begin to consume us, and that's all that we can focus on, and that's all we want in our life. I believe this is why it's so important that we keep ourselves occupied with the things of God. Because no matter how strong you think you are, your flesh is weak. You cannot accomplish things in your flesh. You cannot accomplish things of God in your flesh. If we look at Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 through 21, it says, now the works of the flesh are evident, sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, and it goes on and on from there. But the world tells you to feed your flesh. Whatever you want, you can have it right now, and you deserve it right now. That attitude has run rampant in our society today that you are owed something. Everybody's owed something. Everybody deserves something. And you shouldn't have to work for it. It should just be given to you because that's what you want and that's what your flesh wants, so you deserve it. The next one, the desires of our eyes, defined as coveting or envying what is visually appealing. Examples of this in our world today are materialism, greed for possessions, comparing oneself to others. This is very, very much at play in our society today, especially in our American culture, because everyone wants everything. I need a bigger house. I need a nicer car. I need nicer clothes. I need the newest phone. I need more expensive clothes. I need this, need that. Our society is driven by consumerism. If you don't believe me, just look at how many ads exist in our world today. You can't escape ads. They're getting smarter. Every time I think I got them blocked on my phone, they come back. It's like a cat and mouse game of blocking ads. But it's ads for this. Stuff I don't even need, but it's like you see it and I want it. That's what our attitude has become. It's almost like a toddler. It's like Abby, just give me. Hold your hand out. This, give me. Give me some of that. Give me some of that. Give me some of that. Whatever I want, just give it to me. I need this. And if we're not careful, we start coveting what everybody else has. Well, they've got a nice house, so I need a nice house. They've got a nice car. I need a nice car. Satan uses this desires or this lust of our eyes as an avenue of temptation. Part of the reason Eve listened to the serpent in the garden was that she looked at the forbidden fruit, and it says that it was pleasing to the eye. Just because something is pleasing to the eye or it looks good does not mean that you need it in your life. Not everything that appears good is good. You need to test the spirit of things before you allow it in your life. And there's nothing wrong with having nice things. There's nothing wrong with driving a decent car or driving a car, period. Some of y'all know. That's why the gold Mazda's backed up out there by this mailbox, because the transmission went out in it. So I'm Flintstoning it right now. There's nothing wrong with driving a decent car, living in a good house in a good neighborhood, working a good job that pays good money. Nothing wrong with owning nice things, but you have to ask yourself, what is more important to me, the nice things or my relationship with God? If you're missing so much church because you're having to work to support your lifestyle of excess, you might have your priorities mixed up. When the things of the world start, when I lose that balance, see, we don't have a lot of moderation in our life, in our world. When we start losing that balance and it's like, I've got to work this, this, and this to get what I want and to get these things, it starts taking me away from the stuff of God, it starts taking me away from church, then I've got my priorities messed up. When I live in so much excess that I'm neglecting giving to God and my priorities have gotten messed up, then I'm falling victim to that lust of the eyes. Matthew 6, 22 through 23, the eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. We must guard our heart and our eyes from the distractions of the world. Because I can tell you, what you dwell on most in your mind and through your eyes is what will be eventually make its way into your heart. What you spend all your time focusing on, it better be good things. It better be things of God, because eventually that will take root in your heart. The next one that was mentioned in Scripture is the pride of life. This is defined as arrogance, self-glorification, overconfidence, boasting, putting oneself above God, rejecting servanthood. Eve was tempted by the serpent to disobey God and eat the forbidden fruit of knowledge of good and evil. Eve perceived that the fruit was good for food, pleasing to the eye, and desirable for gaining wisdom. You see, when we get out of this attitude of, I am nothing without God, we get into trouble. Sometimes we get so full of ourselves that we forget that we're only where we are at in life because of God. That the things I have are only because of God. We've got to be careful not to lose that servant attitude. We don't like that because that contradicts with our flesh. Because I want my needs taken care of. I want my stuff taken care of. I want me to be at the top. But when you have a relationship with God and you start with that servant's attitude, you start putting the needs of others above your own, and you start that, it's just a contradiction to our flesh. Servitude directly contradicts everything that the world stands for. Because the world says if you want to get ahead in life, you're just going to have to step over people, step on people. And when you get up to the next level, pull the ladder up behind you so they can't come up either. But that's not of God. That's not what it is, and we must be careful. Proverbs 16 and 18, pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. In Isaiah chapter 14, we see where Satan's fall was due to pride. So we must be humble, and we must submit to God's will. I know I've mentioned Eve's temptation a couple of times, but if you go back and you read Genesis chapter 3, you can see all three of these present. First off, lust of the flesh, because she perceived that it was good for food. Lust of the eyes, because it says that she perceived it was pleasing to the eye. And pride of life, it was desirable for wisdom. She coveted the fruit in these three ways. But if you think about it, all these things I've been talking about, these temptations, these things have remained the same throughout history. Have you ever thought about that, that Satan has not invented any new sins? You know, there's absolutely nothing going on in our world now that hasn't gone on before. We talk about how depraved our world has become. We talk about how immoral things are. But really, the world has always been that way. Go back and read some of Paul's writings. Some of the things that he was talking about that was going on in the churches that he wrote letters about was some pretty bad stuff. Go all the way back to the Old Testament. There's all kinds of bad things that were going on. A lot of bad things that were committed by God's people. So Satan's not inventing new things. There are no new sins. So we have to be careful about this stuff. And I believe the reason there are no new sins, there are no new things like that, is because this stuff still works. If you look at the downfall of man, if you look at the downfall, I'm saying man, but just anybody in here, look at anybody that's had a downfall, somebody that's popular or a celebrity or whatever, it always comes down to these things, money, power, and women. Some of y'all are laughing and smiling. Downfall of every man is one of those three things. Because that's our flesh. I want power. I want money. I want riches. I want all of these things. We have to keep our flesh in check. But the good news is we don't have to live by the system of the world. Because that's what the world has to offer. But let's take a look at what the principles of God are. Let's see what God's system has to offer. See, that's the great thing about God, is that everything that the world offers you, God offers an opposite of that. But first, we have to have a foundation to build upon. Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. If you look at the second half of that verse, and all these things will be added to you. Go back in your study time and read the whole, just start in Matthew 6 and 1. Just read that whole passage there. Not going to go through the whole thing verbatim, but what is basically saying here is that when you put God first, you put his kingdom first, you put righteousness first, you don't have to worry about all these things that are listed. And what Jesus was saying here is that the Gentiles, he was referencing the Gentiles here, which were non-believers at that time, he said, the non-believers, the Gentiles, you see, they worry about all these things and they have anxiousness in their life. You see, they're worried about how to provide for their children. They're worried about where their next meal is going to come from. They're worried about how they're going to pay for this. They're worried about how this is going to happen, which, again, sounds like our world today. Anybody know anybody that's just anxious all the time? Probably work with somebody like that, worried about everything all the time. Guess what? When you're in the kingdom of God, you don't have to worry about that stuff. I said at the beginning of the message, I've proved that this worked. I've gone through it where I lost a job. I've gone through it where I've got a car out there that's broken down. I've gone through it when you pay the bills and there's no money left in the account. But I cannot one time ever remember where God didn't somehow provide. He didn't drop a Ferrari in my driveway, and I didn't open the mailbox to $1 million check, but I've never missed a meal. I've never had to look at one of my children and say, I don't know how we're going to eat tonight. I've never not had a house to live in. God's always provided. If I go back and look through my life at all the things that I have been through, as long as I kept God first, I was taken care of. As long as I was following and doing the things of God, yes, my life may not have been perfect and I may have been going through a storm. I feel like I'm preaching to somebody here today, but I can look back and God was always in control. Every single time, he never let me down. But the world says, well, you got to be anxious about that stuff. Well, what are you going to do if this happens? What are you going to do if that happens? How are you going to pay for this? Guess what? God can provide in the worst economy. God can provide in the worst times in history. So we build this foundation of putting God first. Then next, we have to apply this to our life. And so we start, everything starts with me. Everything starts with yourself. Because if you can't get yourself right, you're not going to get anything else right. So I start with repentance, baptism, receiving the Holy Spirit. That's the foundation which everything in my life is built upon. Salvation, following God. We got to make sure we get that first. We got to make sure that we are building on a foundation of truth. But once we have done that and God starts to transform our life, we go to John chapter 15, verses 4 through 5. And it says, abide in me and I in you as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself. We talk a lot about bearing fruit in this church. I believe that we as Christians should bear fruit and bear good fruit. There should be evidence of transformation in your life. I'm not saying it will be instant. I'm not saying it won't take years or even decades. But you should be able to look at your life now and it should be better off than when you first started in the church or you first started with God. There should be a transformation that happens. So if we just go through the fruits of the Spirit here, if we look at what the world offers, the world says to hate those who are different from you. Does nobody agree with that? Some of y'all didn't pay attention during the election. If you don't agree with me, I hate you. That's what the world offers. If you don't agree with my lifestyle, I hate you. I'm all inclusive up until you don't agree with me, and then we're exclusive. But what does the Word of God say? To love everyone. The Word of God says love your enemies. The Word of God says pray for those who persecute you. Try to find that out in the world. Because the world says if you're my enemy, I'm going to crush you. We leave that up to God. I love you. You get on God's bad side. That's your own fault. The world is full of fear, doubt, and uneasiness. We've already just talked about this. But guess what? Those of us who have God in our life, we have joy and we have peace. Even in the most uncertain times, we can have joy and peace in our life. The world says that whatever you want, get it now. But God's people are patient and they wait on His timing. I think Brother Roberts preached on this just recently. When we get inside God's plan, we mess things up. So we have to learn to be patient. We wait on Him. The world is full of people that are dishonest, scheming, downright mean. But people of God are good. They're faithful. They're gentle. As people of God, we should be the best employees on our job. We should be faithful. We should be good. We should treat people nicely. The world lacks self-control, but God's people exhibit self-control. We're not to fly off the handle at people when they get our order wrong. We don't seek revenge. We don't retaliate against people. But see, that's the contrasting kingdom that I'm talking about. So if you're taking notes so far, if you want to review, I would say that it's a lot better off in God's kingdom. I don't know about you, but I kind of like joy and peace and happiness and all that kind of stuff. The next thing is once we get this in our life, once the fruit is present in our life, then we can carry that over into relationships because we treat others with Christ-like love and respect. If we take care of our personal walk with God, that should carry over to other relationships in our life with our friends, our family, co-workers, spouses. Matthew 7 and 12, so whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them. The golden rule. We teach that at a very young age. Do unto others that have them do unto you. Matthew 22, 37 through 40, talks about loving God and loving your neighbors. Build relationships on godly principles to strengthen unity. God's principles focus on eternal outcomes while this world prioritizes temporary gratification. And that is so true. Like I said, so many people I've met in life that can't see past tomorrow. They live their life just wide open. Whatever happens, happens. But God, we're focused on the eternal. I may not get what I want down here, but I will get something up in heaven. I may suffer. I may have trials and tribulations down here, but I'm not looking at tomorrow. I'm not looking at 10 years down the future. I'm looking at eternity. That's what I'm focused on. That's what gets me through the day when it feels like my world is crashing around, is that I know this earth is just temporary. I know one day I won't have to deal with these things. One day we won't have health issues. We won't have financial problems. We won't have relationship problems. We'll all be together in heaven. That's what keeps us going. This brings me to one of my last points here, is that we live in the world, but we are not of the world. This means we live separate, but we do not isolate. 2 Corinthians 6 and 14. Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers, for what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? If you want to have all this stuff that I've been talking about with the kingdom of God, maintain spiritual boundaries with the people of the world. Who are you spending most of your time with? But more importantly, who is speaking into your life? Like I said, we don't isolate. We are in the world, okay? If you work a job, I doubt everybody at your job is saved. Unless you're self-employed, then I hope everybody's saved. I doubt everybody at your school is saved. Unless you're homeschooled, I hope everybody in the school is saved. But who's speaking into your life? Where are you spending most of your time with? We've got to be careful with that, because, like I said, you go all the way back to the things I was just talking about. This stuff will sneak up on you, because Satan is sneaky. We're always on guard against attacks from Satan, like he's just going to come knocking down the door and try to hit you in the nose. He knows he can't stand toe-to-toe with somebody filled with the Holy Spirit, so he likes to come in the back way. That's why we got to be careful about this stuff. We need to reject sin and worldly systems and embrace Christ in our life. As I get ready to close here, one final scripture, Matthew chapter 6 and verse 24. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other. So this is what I want to leave you with today. We've talked about the contrasting kingdoms. There's two choices. You've got the world and you've got the kingdom of God. That's the only two choices you've got. But guess what? You're the only one that can make that decision. I can't save you. Pastor Roberts can't save you. Nobody in here can make you follow God. Nobody in here can make you live these principles. This is something that you have got to decide on your own. But I will tell you this, that living in the world and living with the principles of the world will only lead to emptiness. You're never going to be fulfilled out there in the world. You will constantly be chasing the next thing. I'm telling you, I have seen it. I can name off names of people that I personally know who have tried it. It does not work. Because when they got what they thought was going to fulfill them, it wasn't good enough. But then they had to go try the next thing. And guess what? They thought, well, this is it. This is what I need. This is what's going to complete my life. And then they got there and they're like, I still feel just as empty as I did. This is why you see so many celebrities and stuff like that that, you know, they have literally everything in the world. Unlimited amounts of money. They got power. They got fame. They got everything. And yet, they end up dying of suicide because they were depressed. And you're thinking, how is this person depressed? They got literally everything they could want. Because there is nothing in the world that can fill that hole that you feel. And I will tell you this, if you have found God, hang on to that. Quit looking. Sometimes I just want to shake people. I'm like, you have found what you have been looking for. Quit looking. It's here. So as we stand today, the thing that we need to ask ourselves today is, which path am I going to follow? Do I want the temporary joy and the values of the world, or am I focused on the eternal principles of God? Am I concerned about just fulfilling, having a good time down here, having some of that temporary feeling, or I'm saying, you know what, no matter what I go through, I'm focused on eternity today. No matter how bad it seems like the world may be crashing down around me, I'm focused on the end. I'm focused on the end goal. I'm focused on eternity. So as our prayer counselors come today, they'll be up front. If you need prayer, I would encourage you, ask one of them to pray for you. But more than that, I would encourage everyone. It don't matter if you've been living for God for 75 years. I think every now and then, sometimes we just need to take stock of where we're at. Because we all need an alignment every now and then. We all need to be kind of scooted back on the path every now and then. There is nothing wrong with some self-examination, just being honest with yourself and say, you know what, I may have started to drift a little bit. I may have got caught. You know what, let's just do an alignment today. I don't want to leave this place without making sure I'm back on the path towards the kingdom of God. So these altars are open as they get ready to sing here today. But I would encourage you, don't rush out of here today. I know it's the holidays. I know we got stuff going on, but let's spend some time in the presence of God today. Let's spend some time just making sure that we are focused on the kingdom of God, that we are focused on the right things, that we're not trying to be persuaded by the systems of this world or the cares of this world.